Greetings and welcome to the final day of the Hearthstone Grand Prix here at DreamHack Winter 2015. Today we have whittled down the field of 200 competitors to just 8, and we will find out who will be the DreamHack champion and the first person to earn major points in the 2016 Hearthstone World Championship. My name is Frodan. I'm joined by Nimsh and Lothar, two great Polish casters and players. And we're back here to see who is going to go all the way. And we've had a long journey to get to where we are, but some of the most fun Hearthstone we've seen yet.
Yeah, absolutely. We had so many fun matches. And League of Explorers is live. And we have Bran, we have Reno, we have all those explorers already being played, and the decks, the new decks. I'm most excited about the Malygos deck myself that Purple is playing, but there was so much fun as well. We've seen Kel'Thuzad, we've seen some dragons in the tiebreaker match, and now we have our top 8.
Yeah, I mean, this is the first it's the second Swiss, but the biggest Swiss tournament we had yet to date when it comes to offline tournaments, and I'm really happy to see that so many known names are in the top 8, and hopefully, well, the champion will be worthy of the title.
I think he will be. I think it's one of those things where you look at the field of competitors and all these guys that have gotten here to the top 8, they really deserve to be here in the competition. I don't really think of any player that, you know, it's like they lucked their way through completely. It's like they've demonstrated they have strong proficiency in their decks, they understand the metagame, and they definitely have their unique strategies. I think what stands out to me the most is strategies like Purple bringing the Dragon Warlock. That's something people were just not really expecting, nor did they think it was very good until Purple won something like 17 or 18 games in a row with it before dropping his first game. And then now all of a sudden he's here in the top 8. But we do have a good mix of players from all over the world, and that's what makes it really cool.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also want to talk about Hoi, because Hoi was undefeated throughout the series, so he is 10-0 right now. And he brought Paladin. With his Paladin, he was 21-1. So a lot of people say Paladin is really popular, but to play to a level to almost never lose a game requires some excellence for sure.
Okay. Well, he did drop one series. Oh, he lost his final round of Swiss, I believe. Yes. But it was an inconsequential match, considering that he was already qualified for the top 16 at the time. He did win a match that was pretty tough against Kranich. We say that facetiously because he was just able to stomp him with Druid 3-0. He is up against a player, though, who has also been underestimated, to say the least. I feel like Orange always comes into tournaments and people write him off, both fans and players, so to speak. They look at other Archon members to make bigger splashes, Firebat, Amaz, even Soleil to a certain extent. And, you know, back when Sixo was on the team, they look at those guys and they're like, well, Orange, yeah, he can make it, but he's rock solid. I feel like almost every tournament he enters, he gets to the top 8 every single time.
Yeah, and he has two major titles under his belt. So
that's
it's
right.
Like not it's not like he's an underachiever, you would say.
No, not at all.
But we were talking about how Hoi is consistent and why his results are so insane. And we come to a conclusion, if you're playing flawlessly or almost flawlessly and you get good draws, then
that's the winning combination.
That's a winning combination. And Hoi looks like that for the past 2 days. He's drawing really well, but at the same time, I don't think we saw a single mistake when he was on stream. He's really playing like one of the best players in the world. So something to consider, because I still remember the times when he first won the VAR game, and everyone was kind of, you know, just reluctant to see him as a good player. And
it's because he was beating a lot of fan favorites at the time.
Yes.
And Hoi continued to qualify for many events. You know, winning Gfinity was another really good achievement. And, you know, for example, qualifying for the One Nation to Gamer tournament, going to the finals there.
Being in Prague as well.
Being in Prague at the EU finals. This guy has definitely proven himself as one of the breakout performances of 2015. In fact, I often compare him to RDU of last year, where it's just like, no matter what you do, you're going to see him qualify for competitions and probably beat the player, your favorite players. But, you know, over time, he'll probably make his mark to the point where people are going to be expecting Hoi to perform well. And considering that he's on a team with 6-0 and Elskaka, those are two other players that you're looking at where it's like, wow, this Na'Vi team could be the best team in the world.
Yeah, they are really good, and all of the players having great achievements as well. And we have Hoi, we have Orange now. Both of them, if they win the tournament, will not be surprised. But one of them is going to be eliminated right now in this very match.
That's right. But the good thing that's on the line here for all these players is that they're at least guaranteed some money, and they're at least guaranteed some prize pool. In fact, let's go ahead and look at some of the facts of how everything is shaped up. We have 1,205 $12,500 for first place, $7,500 for second, and then $5K, $2K for the splits down though below. And then, of course, for anybody who's wondering how we got here, we had 200 players play in Swiss with a top 16 cutoff, and we're still playing last year's standing best of five. We're not changing that at all for the round of eight all the way through to the finals.
With no ban.
Because we don't want to change. We don't want to change the format, because if all of a sudden you add a deck and you add a ban, that actually completely changes your lineup strategy.
Yes, definitely.
So we want to respect and honor that all the way through. And so far, it's been pretty good. I mean, even though we do see some Paladin dominance, we have seen multi-layered strategies from different people who aren't just solely dependent on the Paladin. Some people even choose not to bring Paladin.
Yeah, absolutely. Some people even brought combo Warlock that we've seen from Dragon Albert.
That's right.
And some really cool decks. There was the tiebreaker match, Kranich versus Jungle Brawl, and the decks that he brought were super funny. There was Reno. There was super greedy cards that Kalthus had as well. So players brought their strategies. We've even seen Dresti. We haven't seen Dresti on stream, but some people actually brought Dresti and thought this can carry them to the top 16.
Every class was represented. You know, Zed'Alot, of course, carrying the priest flag. Unfortunately, it was dropping in the round of 16, but a really great performance by him as well. One of his first LAN events, or, you know, offline events, so to speak. And I feel like the future of Hearthstone being built on this kind of foundation, with a lot of great competitors coming in here with cool stories, because when you have nine rounds, there's bound to be some really weird stuff that happens that you're not really expecting, as well as you're starting to see, again, the same players go through the rounds. It's like, well, there's got to be some new consistency to these players. It's pretty amazing to see some people go 9-0 through these Swiss. But, of course, this is one of the biggest challenges, because it's single elimination. And no matter how well you've performed up to this point, you know, Hoi, of course, winning 3-0 in almost every single series that he's played except for one. He might just lose here, and then it's like, well, it doesn't matter how you got here. You could have a 90% win rate, but you lose one series from this point on, and you're done.
This is why in the traditional card games, it's not about winning the event as much as in Hearthstone. It's about being in the top 8, being in the top 16, because the players have to prove themselves to be in that cutoff. Mm-hmm. And when you look at deck lists, at the tournament reports, there's always mention of the whole cutoff, and not only like not only about the winner.
Right.
And I hope this kind of tournaments will change the way we look at Hearthstone competitors.
Okay. Yeah, that's a really good point, Lothar. And I hope I can start with us as us casters. Stop focusing on who's winning necessarily, but also who's making the cutoff, because, you know, we're talking about Orange specifically. Again, he's a guy that's placed top 8 many times, even as recently as just a couple weeks ago in a stacked field of competitors at Seed Story Cup. Another tournament she's also won, by the way, in C-Story Cup 3. So let's go ahead and go into the first game. Druid, versus the Hunter. And this is a class that is capable of sweeping on both sides. Hunter is still proven to be a class that's often forgotten, but still potent. And Druid, of course, very consistent these days still. Although, we'll have to see how it comes out to shape once the early draws happen.
Ooh. Yeah, very interesting.
Two things that come to mind. You have two Arcane Golems in the Hunter, as well as Freezing Trap. So, Freezing Trap tells you it's mid-range or hybrid version. And then the Arcane Golem confirms that it's hybrid. But at the same time, many people are dropping Arcane Golems for one piece of that card in favor of Arcane Horse Rider. Which is a better Wolfheart Rider. I mean, a different Wolfheart Rider.
Yeah, so Hybrid versus Druid. A very interesting matchup. Not good draw for Hoi. He didn't get any ramp elements and so many expensive cards. Normally, this matchup is in favor of Druid. If Druid gets Ascurrent or some ramp elements as well, then he can stop the Hunter. But on the other hand, there is the Freezing Trap as well, and High Mains. So, we'll see.
We were saying it. You know, Hoi yesterday was drawing Wild Growth perfectly on turn two every single time. But this game, he doesn't have any ramp or plays the first three turns. But at the same time, neither does Orange. He has a very awkward hand. And I feel like with both of these slow starts, that's actually not too bad for the Druid.
Yep.
Because it's like, well, maybe I don't ramp, but at the same time, you're not doing anything either, so I'm stalling perfectly fine.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Orange gets Mad Scientist, but this is Eagle Hornball. You want to kill that Aspirant as soon as possible. But he doesn't really have the call. He needs to get like a 2-drop maybe to follow up with Mad Scientist.
Oh, that's an Innervate though.
Oh, and Thorison as well in hand.
Yeah, so Thorison will smooth out the rest of the curve for basically the next three or four turns. Hoi will have many plays. And Orange does have ways to stabilize. He can use Quick Shot here to eliminate the Thorison, which almost certainly he'll need to as a high priority. And then he has the coin High Main.
Yeah, but on the other hand, there is Sylvanas and Silence as well for Hoi, so he will be able to deal with the first time main.
The problem for Orange is the fact that the Unleashed Hands will most likely get him two maximum dogs. And this kind of value for a 3-mana card from Hunter is something that we don't want to see at all. Especially in Hybrid Hunter, who specializes in just dropping and ending the game with 7 high main.
Well, I mean, there is a freezing trap in the deck, right, for Orange, so maybe he cashes. Although you're very scared of just wrathing Sylvanas, though. That's like a really scary thing. Yep. In fact, he is willing to just kill Sylvanas here and take it really slow.
And give a Wild Growth for free for Hoi, who was, you know, kind of not having a good start, so you can assume that his hand is really stacked with high cost mana minions.
Well, he did play Emperor Thorzin, though. So
yeah, he did.
But
he
now
did,
it's like an additional.
But on the other hand, this is what you have to do, because you want to play your high main, and you will not be able to do it when the Sylvanas is on board.
Of course.
I really like Sylvanas' play by Hoi, by the way, because he locked the coin high main. He was expecting the coin high main to happen.
Yeah, I mean, that's just his powerful tempo play on the board available. And I like it because he knows that the coin high main is a possibility, but once Sylvanas is on the board preemptively, you can make some really powerful trades. Now, I'm really curious if Orange has continued to include odd tech in his Hunter, like the Stranglethorn Tiger. I know he really loves this card because he loves that fact that it's stealth, and you just have this 5/5 waiting in the shadows, being able to kill command or be able to pick off really good trades and get guaranteed damage in. And that's the kind of stuff that I know a lot of players even criticize. Even his teammates, they're like, why do you play Stranglethorn Dagger? It's bad. And Orange is like, no, it's a good card. It's really underrated. And that's what makes it really fun, because these players have very strong opinions on what's a good and not good card.
It did work for him before in the past. The tournaments he took, he actually had some interesting tech choices. And, well, Kill Command is okay.
I mean, he just used the silence right before the high main came down, too. So that's a good sign in Orange's mind. However, he does know Freezing Trap is also out onto the field. But I guess the Keeper of the Grove would have to bounce back and spend his entire turn silencing. And he still can't kill the Drake.
Well, you can, but then the Drake will most likely trade with the 7 high main, will be finished off by the hero power or by a Wrath. So the 7 high main doesn't do anything.
Okay.
There's swipe right now as well, so he can swipe the high main and kill one of the hyenas. It's not like you really have to silence the high main.
Yeah, not when he did draw the swipe.
Yeah, the swipe also gives you ability to develop the Darnassus Aspirant. And it's not the mana crystal that matters so much. It's the 2/3 body that allows you to trade onto the board, because this hunter outside the high main has very weak minions. They're not looking at Houndmasters and Lothebs necessarily all
the time. Might be Dr. Boom.
Well, Houndmaster would be cool with the Stranglehold Tiger.
It would be, but I think Orange, with two Arcane Golems, you really think he has room for more of an interventional approach? Yeah, I mean, it would be cool on paper, but I mean, there's also a lot of synergies like that that can't be afforded to be played in this deck, so it must be quicker than that.
I like the decision to go to for face here. You don't really have to kill the minions because you are super healthy, and you're the one pressuring at this point, and you're forcing Hunter to kill your minions while you deal 4 damage to the face.
Well, incidentally enough, because he leaves up these minions, there is actually Unleash the Hounds opportunity for Orange. And let's see what happens here, because if he gets a couple of good juggles and good trades in, no swipe has been used. So maybe something can come back here for Orange. Oh, that's not good, though.
Yeah, Orange has a chance to come back, but on the other hand, Force of Nature, Savager combo is still a threat, so even if Hoi doesn't have those cards yet, just putting Orange to a really low range forces him to trade into minions and always kill them, because the threat of the combo will linger there.
Oh man, too many juggles to face. I mean, I guess in the end you do need to kill your opponent, but that's not the way you want it to be done. And he does end up trading into the Drake and the Aspirant, but the pain train will continue here. Now, one thing to consider is that Orange also is running out of resources, so his reach is going to be really short, and he knows that his opponent has a Keeper of the Grove to also tempo down the Knife Juggler. So he's going to be working on very low amount of damage, and Hoi's at 24 with two Ancient of Lore heals in his hand if he really wants to start being able to be defensive.
Yeah.
So Hunter's problem is the fact that he's not packing any draws usually. and but he has the advantage of having the hero power, which is twice as powerful as other hero powers usually. So you can think about it like an additional card each turn, but it still might not be enough to seal the game, especially when he's at 15 HP and it comes closer and closer to drawing the combo for Hoi, which will immediately just seal the game.
That's right. But he doesn't have the combo yet, and Orange will consistently keep dealing damage every turn. So if Hoi decides to draw cards with the second Ancient of Lore, that will be as much heal as he has in the deck.
But he doesn't need to. He's got Azure Drake. He also has the Keeper of the Grove.
And a Dirt of the Claw.
I mean, that's a lot of ways to get in to effectively gain health here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
He goes for the Ancient of Lore.
He's so confident. He drops Ancient of Lore for healing because he knows he can innervate a 5-drop. Mm-hmm. Most likely the Keep, not the Keeper, the Druid of the Claw here.
He's just searching for a combo parts because he knows whenever he draws the combo, he'll be able to finish, especially now with Druid of the Claw as well. If he gets Savage Roar, Druid of the Claw is 6 damage itself. He didn't get it, though.
He didn't get it. However, he still has innervate opportunities to use Keeper or Druid of the Claw.
It's weird that he's going for the Keeper when he can curve out perfectly with the Druid of the Claw when he saw Kill Command already used. Mm-hmm. So you can next turn, you can go for both Keeper of the Groves. Keeper of the Groves to finish off any kind of minion that will be on board because that curves out perfectly at 10 mana.
He does it because of the Savage Roar. He will have a couple of draws with Wildgrove, but basically he just wants to get the Savage Roar and go all in with everything.
Force of Nature 11.
Yeah. No, it's not enough.
Not enough.
Mana. He's one mana or... Yeah. If only Wild Growth would allow him to go to 11. He could have played it last turn.
Well, he can still Wild Growth and get Savage Roar and win by that. Because that would be 9 plus 6, 15.
Imagine how a different game would be Hearthstone if you could go above 10 mana.
Isn't the idea that control decks would be too good? Because then it's like... As the game continues to go on, just like they would have ridiculous plays.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Just play the big minion and then like do something with the board.
It'd be a greedy snowball, right? Where just like two faceless manipulators, and you just like you play like Ragnaros faceless, like on turn like a 13 mana. It's like, all right, that's good.
Let's do this.
And just like 16 bomb, or like even worse, like two faceless as you get to 18 mana.
Well, that probably seals the deal. 5 damage with the hunter, no cards in hand. Even though Druid is
quick
12.
Shot.
Iron Beguile does not hoot, do hoot. It.
So I was thinking like quick shot into Huffer hero power, but even then that is only nine damage
for.
I mean, 46. That would have been kind of close, but still not really. Like Hoi in the end was still being aggressive, which is not usually a position that you usually see when Druid has like all those defensive options. But I think he says, you know, rather than drag this game out and give Hunter a chance to draw into second high main or something stupid like that, then I'm going to just close out the game. So a game one win here for Hoi, and his Druid streak continues. However, Orange does have two classes which are well equipped to take down the Druid. The Paladin and the Warrior these days are some of the best tools against Druid outside of the Tempo Mage. To kill this class.
Yeah, absolutely, but it's not 100% win, and Druid is such a flexible class that it can maybe take those classes as well. And Hoi obviously has to stay with the class because we're playing Last Hero Standing. He did 3-0 before with that deck.
It is true, and I think with Last Hero Standing, no ban, the key is to bring very flexible decks that are not only good against the metagame, but also dynamic with how they adapt to stuff. Druid is one of those because you can always be defensive or aggressive depending on your ramp. And you can always just cheat the curve like that. And then Paladin, of course, has the strongest curve currently in the game. Whether you're playing Secrets or mid-range, it's somewhat inconsequential because of the early game foundation.
Yeah.
But when you think about Druid in general as a flexible class, you have to be aware that it's one of the few classes in the game that has cards with multiple usage. An example, Druid of the Claw serves multiple purposes in the deck.
Yeah.
Keeper of the Grove, the same. Yep. It can be aggressive, it can be defensive, it can be great against Freeze Mage for unfreezing your own minions.
Even combo.
Yeah, of course. Combo is a...
Yeah, yesterday we saw like Hoi silence, and or not Hoi, it was, I think, Boris, silence, innervate combo. I was like, well, that's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Like that. Oh, yeah, that was true. Yeah. He used the innervate to Keeper of the Grove with the combo. Which is kind of nuts. And the Paladin is a second class that is kind of going to a direction of being a very flexible class. We can see that with Keeper of Ulduman, who can be aggressive and defensive whatever you choose, because you can shrink down your opponent minion and just trade up.
Yep.
Or you can buff up your own minion and race, or just, you know, trade with a lesser minion.
Yeah, yeah, that's pretty good. Like, even Mistress Challenger, when you drop it, it's like Noble Sacrifice is protecting you from one attack and creating some minions, so it's both aggressive and defensive. Mm. I really like playing those decks.
And speaking of the devil,
you have a lot of choices. Ooh. When you play those kind of
decks. Oh, man.
Decks.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
I don't know, though. Like, this, I mean, sure, it's a good opening hand for Orange, so to speak, but with that kind of ramp, with all three options available, with follow-up, like, the Thorsen is going to be really powerful once you stabilize the board, and if he picks up another way to just
oh man, this is so important, because sometimes when you have this opening as a druid, you can't draw into Force of Nature's and more wild growths, which is really bad for you. But if you keep drawing the big creatures, that Thorsen will be so amazing.
He's got even boom next turn, and yeah, it's one of those things where you evaluate, like, do I wild growth here, do I kill off the shielded mini bot? If you kill Minibot, you still can innervate Thorsen, and then it'll cost 6 mana boom, but you might lose your Darnassus Aspirant to muster for battle, so you're still not exactly able to play boom. But you also could just go for the YOLO wild growth and then let your opponent deal with stuff and then try to innervate boom, and if not, you innervate Thorsen, which also reduces the cost of boom. So there's a lot of choices here for Hoi. I like the most aggressive approach, because Paladin Curves can really punish Druid, and it's not necessarily the greatest matchup, so I like taking a little bit riskier paths to try to sneak out a win. So I like that Hoi went for this decision here.
Yeah, absolutely. It's pretty good. And yeah, would you expect Big Game Hunter from Paladin? But even if Ooh. There's no Big Game Hunter, you might expect Aldor Peacekeeper. So Dr. Boom can be answered.
Well,
that looks like
not
a
only
final paying hand.
Not only has he got the Dr. Boom, but he's also got some combo pieces to follow it up with more burst, and it is a long time before Mysterious Challenger can impact. However, there is the Keeper of Old Demon, so...
But does it change a lot, because there are still two bombs on board, and...
Yeah, Creeper can take some damage.
Yeah, it can, but if you want to kill the Dr. Boom, then you have to sacrifice your Boom Bot.
Well, Lothar is a good as good answer as any, actually, because that's something you see Dr. Boom on turn 5, and you need to answer that. Keeper is fine. Obviously, you would
it's
like
not
to have
turn 5.
It's turn 3,
yeah,
actually.
It's turn 3.
He coined Darnassus.
It is.
Wild growth and then innervate boom. Turn 3 boom is probably what you is probably as good as it gets. And you know what? I mean, as much as this innervate can really sting, I think the Keeper of Uldwan might make it tolerable.
Depends where the bomb lands. But for Hoi, it's still amazing, because he can follow up with Thorsen.
Do you kill Boom immediately, or do you kill off the Aspirant for the ramp? I think it's still okay, because it's turn 6, so you're not afraid of the Ancient of Lore. You're only afraid of Thorsen.
Yeah.
Oh, he's going to get punished by Keeper of the Grove, because you can silence your own Boom.
And be a 7-7
And go
again.
To town! I don't know.
It's such a cool play, though.
It is. I like where Orange is thinking, because he's like, well, if he doesn't have Keeper, then all of a sudden I actually have tempo on the board. Like, if this hits face, okay,
okay,
that's not
that's
a really
fine,
big boom
that's
bot.
Fine. Yeah.
That's absolutely fine. Unless it's going to get
hit
killed
face?
By the second bomb.
No! Oh. It wasn't that great.
Snake Eyes.
And so if he didn't have Keeper the Grove, this is actually an excellent play from Orange. But it just so happened that Hoi had a backup plan in case it was Peacekeeper or Keeper of Old Demon. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think the boom was ultimately the most versatile play here.
But still, the game is undecided. Even if he silences the boom and kills the Keeper of Uldemon, then we have Sludge Belcher into Mysterious Challenger into possibly Dr. Boom or Lothab and something else and Tyrion.
It's
what
true.
What do you think about just Shade of Naxxramas and
hero
trade
power.
With the yeah trade of the boom to hero power? Because you build up the board and you might... The Keeper of the Grove will be more important against Avengers.
Or Tyrion. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense.
Okay.
Because Keeper is really valuable in the matchup, and even though there is a lot of temptation whenever you can play Keeper, it's probably better to keep it.
I guess it depends on how you feel this matchup, and it looks like the Keeper of the Grove being kept there when you drew the Shade in Naxxramas, I can definitely see why he wants to hold on to it. However, it seems like he's going to be losing the board, and Mysterious Challenger will be really powerful. Although, playing Emperor Thorsen will really bait the Lothab into attacking it, and then there's no minions with Mysterious Challenger, making it much weaker.
Well,
it's still a 6-6, and gets
yeah.
all the secrets on the board.
I mean, I'm saying it's not bad play by any means. It's actually a very good play. It's just it's not as insane as it would be if you even had a couple of 1-1s with it.
Yeah. Also, when you play Mistress Challenger and trade Lothab into Thorison, you're actually getting a good board, and Hoi doesn't have a great follow-up.
I mean, would you even trade? Maybe you keep another minion on, but I feel like you would trade when your opponent Thorison's.
Is there anything else than Thorison here?
Not particularly. It's worth evaluating. Like, well, I could put a keeper, kill Lothab, and have no board before Mysterious Challenger. But your hand does continue to improve with Thorison reducing the cost of everything. So, I mean, here's the big question.
I think you do trade for sure.
How do you deal with this Mysterious Challenger effectively afterwards, or do you even do anything?
So they came Hunter.
You can't silence that Avenge. That's something you can do, but it doesn't even do that much.
Yeah, it's tough.
You might even not attack here. Just the Palliser Shredder was a good pickup because that's some minion he can put on board. So maybe the turn will be just put Shredder, Hero Power, not attack. Mm-hmm. Allow it to get Competitive Spirit.
Yeah. Do you want to point out, by the way, that all 8 players have revealed the deck list through the administrators? Because we recognize some people have been on stream and haven't at this point, we have chosen to just keep it open for everyone. So Arn should be aware that Hoi has no Repentance in the deck, so it's not like there's any ability for like Hoi to mind game him. Hoi is very well aware of like what kind of secrets there are from Arn, and vice versa.
Cool to see that, because that's something that was always made in the traditional card games. So
yep.
Nice.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
And some players actually spend their nights practicing.
Yeah,
specific
studying,
matchups,
like asking practice partners, and you know that's where like having guys who are really dedicated to the game, like 6-0, Oskaka, and then for Orange, like having Fire Batting Crew.
And well, actually, don't sleep at all.
The first thing I saw when I arrived was Torok playing versus Yogg. Torok versus Yogg were like practicing matchups against Ersi.
Yeah, Torok will be playing Ersi. Those are two players you might not know, but they might bring some cool stuff that you guys will be looking forward to. Ersi has that OTK Warlock that you were mentioning. So we do see that the Sludge Belcher here will be really problematic, as the Mysterious Challenger won't be contested. Orange is still hesitating, though, because there's multiple ways to go about this if you want to isolate targets or if you want to like set up Noble Sacrifice, because he ultimately wants the best board for Tyrion, and that'll be the key. He's even trading with Shade, so that way he can completely shut down this Shredder from being able to do anything useful.
Well, he has the belt. This is like a huge pickup for this turn. Because now Hoi is facing two targets that he has to deal with. If only he would have a swipe would change something, he would not.
Yeah,
Swipe would change a lot.
Well, Swipe would change a lot too. Like, if that Keeper was swiped, then all of a sudden Force of Nature becomes a lot better with how everything interacts. So
can he
now
do something with that force if he attacks with the Pilot of Shredder into Belcher, Hero Power?
Was he able? He's able to clear Knife Juggler and Belcher.
He might have no choice but to maybe draw with Ancient of Lore.
The problem
to
is
try to get bigger answers like Big Game Hunter or like Wrath or something as time goes on.
Well, he can draw Big Game Hunter and Innervate.
Yeah, if you're really good at Hearthstone, that's what you do.
It sometimes happens. I've seen Life Coach do that.
Jesus. Well, I mean, if you play Keeper and you play Force Nature or something, and then Tyrion's, you lose anyway. So I like the draw here from Hoi, but does he draw anything significant? He gets Savage Roar.
Oh! He got that Big Game Hunter.
He got the Big Game Hunter.
Whoa, awesome. Dr. Boom is another great card for Orange.
So yeah, after you BGH one good target, another one comes out here. I mean, I don't even think he needs Dr. Boom per se. Tyrion itself might close out this game.
He can just go for face.
Because
the decision,
the swings for some of the two best legendaries in the game, Dr. Boom and Tyrion, belong in this deck on top of what people consider the best 6-mana minion. And that is a product of what this deck can generate.
There's another 6-mana minion that Hoi just picked up, but it's too late. So with Big Game Hunter killing the 10-5,
well,
can he survive?
He might have. He has some Force of Nature Savage Roar, and he's looking at how the trades line up here. But it looks like he's still just going to die for the Boom follow-up, because as much as he BGH and starts clearing,
can he kill him in 2 turns, maybe?
He
like
can't really stop it. I mean, actually, he may stay alive with the Keeper shutdown. Like on the knife juggler, perhaps? Okay.
Well, you don't have to silence Tyrion.
Yeah, that's right. You want to silence Tyrion as well. Man, you just want like three keepers in your hands. You just
well, he's allowed to kill
oh,
the...
Oh, that's some heals.
Yeah, I guess so.
He's able to clear the...
Yeah. This is very good from Poi.
There's Blessing, and it's... he needs to hit with the knife. Can he go for that?
He can also hit three times with the knife with Dr. Boom.
And played in Noble Sacrifice for additional knife.
So many knives.
Yeah. Sounds good. So that's the four damage he makes up anyways.
Yep.
How much damage is there if Poi picks up Savage Roar? That's 14 plus 620.
Oh, that's a good
27.
Question. 27?
28 with the hero power because Force of Nature is discounted.
And he would be able to heal for free.
But if he kills the one free, then it's out of range. And the Noble Sacrifice is going to play... Oh, he's not playing Noble Sacrifice.
Going to jug on the 4-1.
Ooh. Oh.
That is good.
Now Swipe wouldn't be the key.
Second Force of Nature is not what he's looking for.
We can cycle with the one mana Wild Growth because his hand's not playable. Besides, one, you only can play one of your cards anyways. So let's see what Wild Growth... Maybe Hoi can surprise us with the second VGH. I don't remember seeing that in his Druid, though.
That's an Innervate, which means he has 11 mana, so he can cast Double Force of Nature.
It's double just Force of Nature! Oh my god.
That's actually pretty good, because now he can clear most of his board.
Yeah, I mean, and maybe he survives.
By the way, it was one card off to get the Big Game Hunter with Innervate.
Oh yeah, that's a really good point. But, I mean, Hoi is he's fighting back, man. And if he can survive this onslaught, he can be one of the first people in the history of Hearthstone to experience the Challenger, Boom, Tyrion, Wombo combo, and live to tell the tale.
Yeah, but it wasn't in order. It was 10, 6, Mysterious Challenger.
Oh, that was good for him.
Wow, not bad. Oh, that is that lethal?
That's 5.
That's 5, that's 7. And, no.
That's only 7. I mean, he's still in it.
Yeah, he can play Shredder here. This
it's
is
hard,
really
though.
Board. And we've seen Double Ancient Floor already. So... if that's Sylvanas, would be on board, but it's not. Taunt? Wrath?
Doomsayer?
Doomsayer. Okay, but it's still Bomb.
Oh, wait.
Hit
what, if,
four.
What if you play Sylvanas, attack the Boombot, rat. Wait, no, Sylvanas can't die.
No,
Sylvanas can't die for.
Okay,
Boombot
Doomsayer,
damage.
Boys, guys.
I think it's time to see a Doomsayer.
And it's not.
That's a one eyed cheat!
Yeah, it doesn't change much. So Hoi concedes this game, and it's a 1-1.
That was a long game.
It was. It was surprising.
Druid hung in there. And, Hoi navigated some really tough situations, you know, making some really, you know, complicated plays of trading and staying alive. But ultimately, even if he did, could he win the game? Because his hand, like Paladin was in the case of they can just make 1-1s and play, like, mini-bot, and then Druid just might die because he doesn't have enough health. And Paladin, meanwhile, was at, like, 28 health, not really getting challenged by anything. So even though it looked like he might hold on, that was a one-sided stomp.
Absolutely.
It's very peculiar to see because Druid had the most of the insane turns, right? The first turns, most impactful ones, like turn 3, Dr. Boom. And yet, the new drop from League of Explorers... Keeper of Ulduman just changed the whole pace of the game. Without that, I don't think Orange would have been able to just go out of the damage that Dr. Boom was delivering.
Well, I mean, I'm still wondering if he would silence Dr. Boom and just attack into the Keeper. He would have a 7-4 on board. So that was a decision he didn't make at the time.
I think if you asked Hoi the cards he wanted to start off last game, it was very close to what he wanted with three options for ramp. Followed by like Keeper Grove and also like Boom very early on.
But Orange has had a really good curve as well.
Yeah, he did. Speaking of, there's a clash of styles already. You can see Secret Keeper versus Chao. This is something that a lot of players debate whether or not they want to be defensive or more proactive in this matchup. And you can already see that Hoi is stumbling a little bit. That fact that he has the hero power on turn 2 is a really big deal. Another thing that I want to point out is that Orange had the opportunity, and he took a long time to evaluate it, is to whether or not he wanted to keep Challenger into the hand because he's on the coin, which is often a big reason of why you want to even be on the coin in the first place in this matchup, because everything else is a con. You're just behind in the curve, but the one thing you can do is Challenger before your opponent.
Yeah, that's a very good point, Rodden, and I'm really surprised that he didn't keep it. I think Mysterious Challenger, and especially in the mirror, is so important that you always keep it when you're on the coin.
The problem is, like, if you keep Mystery Challenger and your opponent has a really good start with Secret Keeper, Shielded Mini Bots, into Master for Battle, you just keep sitting on the Mystery Challenger and seeing how you lose the game.
It is true.
It is a risk.
It is true. It is conditioned on the rest of your starting hand, I think. Maybe Orange felt like, well, if I have Chao and Mini Bot and, like, Mysterious Challenger, maybe I do keep that.
Yeah, I think Master for Battle is much more important in this matchup, actually.
Even so, yeah, I agree. Like, cleaning up all these little 1-1s are really important. And now that Hoi saw Coin, his Mysterious Challenger has all of a sudden gotten much better. And when you hit the first Challenger, and what happens is usually Challenger into your opponent playing the Mysterious Challenger, the person who plays Challengers first can basically pick the trades off really well, and he'll get his Competitive Spirit activating, allow him to even trade properly. So what happens is Orange usually probably can't do anything even if he plays.
Yeah, Challenger. Not only that, because he also has Dr. Boom, so it's Challenger into Boom, which already is great. And Orange in turn 4, he has that Keeper, but it's not doing much, so going for the Pilot Shredder. Mm-hmm. He can kill the 5-2 with Zombie Chao, and then he kind of takes the board.
But not for long.
Not for long. And there is Silence as well, Knife Juggler.
By the way, I just want to point out how great is Keeper of Voldoman. It's just a...
Oh, look at
such
that
a flexible card.
Yeah, Keeper is great. I'm really looking forward to seeing more Keeper in the competitive play. It's not silencing the minions, so it should be balanced, but the flexibility of the card is amazing.
That Master for Battle was such a big draw, because you set up now five minions before the Mysterious Challenger, and Orange doesn't have Consecration. Orange's best draw on this next turn is Consecration alone. If not, he's going to get completely swept away.
And if that's unstable go,
oh my god! Are you serious?
Well,
Nymph,
that's a
you
good
are
one.
A prophet.
Yeah, Orange, it sometimes happens.
Orange must have done some weird voodoo magic before the series started.
This is like a gift wrapped win.
Wow.
I mean, maybe not win.
Well, it's not a win, but it's great. It's
He did the same exact thing in the last History Cup against those Kaka off his Shredders. It's like, this is insane.
Yeah, that was amazing. Because Juggler into Master for Battle is one of the best turn 5s you can get as a Paladin. But Hoi actually picked up Tyrion as well. So now it's Mystery Challenger into Boom into Tyrion. Can Orange fight against that?
He can, because now he developed Belcher beforehand. And all of a sudden, he can pick apart the secrets much more effectively by popping it with the Master for Battle weapon. And then killing off the redemption token, and then setting up your own secrets. You have Noble Sacrifice to deflect some stuff and avenge buff your own minions. So it's like, this is something that Orange can all of a sudden start climbing back.
Well, Hoi has his Owl in the hand, but at the same time, he can play the Owl on turn 9, because he really wants to cure out with the Boom into Tyrion.
Yeah, but there's Keeper of Uldamon just waiting for that Boom as well, so... This game is still undecided.
It's like the problem with the Noble Sacrifice here, because everyone's like, "Well, he has a weapon." Is if you're not completely sure his Noble Sacrifice, you're attacking a 1/4 weapon into a 3/3, and nothing could happen. So, it's one of those things where sometimes it might mess with their opponent's head. But Hoi should probably be aware that this might be the Noble Sacrifice Avenge combination or Redemption. Redemption could be really problematic because as soon as that Belcher dies, another Belcher comes back. With another slime that comes afterwards. Let me
think. Well, it seems like Dr. Boom is green, so he might be thinking about... But because you've mentioned all those secrets, you probably never play all this turn. All achieves nothing. Just silencing Belcher achieves nothing as
well. He's like, screw it, I'm not going to try to play with Redemption. You know, it's like, whatever, let it be. And Keeper of Uldamon is another huge tempo swing for Orange. And it could
be
the beginning
Tyrion.
Of a huge comeback. But again, he's behind on the threats. He's behind because his opponent will be playing Tyrion before him.
Yeah, Dr. Boom stays on board as well. Interesting.
Trades his own Belcher, so he basically gave information to Hoi that it's not Redemption.
And very good point. Now now Hoi might change his ways.
Well, you still play Tyrion.
Well, now he feels comfortable attacking with his weapon first. Oh, well, I guess Orange might lose this anyways.
Aww, losing the 1-2.
So, somewhat inconsequential, but now, you know, maybe that Avenge buff will hit onto a relevant target and give your ability to trade, but the Tyrion on board is just such a big deal.
You might actually also go for face damage, because you are the one being aggressive. If you just drop Tyrion here, you force your opponent to trade into your minions.
I don't know, man. If you put Tyrion before your opponent's Tyrion, that is some 10 out of 10 stuff, man, because you get the Divine Shield.
Yeah, you do play Tyrion, but you don't kill the minions here. You go for face for 7 damage.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
I'm thinking about it. Like, the tempo swing, just by allowing yourself to trade with a 4-3 or a 3-4, might have a bigger advantage, especially when you're facing a Titan without their qualities. Mm. But the weapon... Ooh. The weapon swing, the first weapon swing, 5 damage for 0 mana might be even more important. The fact that, of course, that Hoi has a owl in his hand.
Yeah, and you expect Tyrion on 8, so yeah. You know you're going to silence it.
Yeah, the owl's really big. This game is just such a meme, man. Everyone's just like Challenger into boom, Tyrion into more Challengers and low types. It's like
yeah, they draw good cards, man.
Well, you know, Arn's thinking like, you know, can I just take out this Tyrion immediately? And, you know, it's going to be putting a lot of power on the board. In fact, if Hoi draws one of his Blessing of Kings, I believe that is the game.
Oh, man. Paladin is so strong. I really wonder, how did ever Arthas actually kill Uther? They had to play a really good game.
Well, they didn't play cards, that's for sure. Dude.
Are you sure, though?
I'm pretty sure that's not what happened, although that would make a great anime. Well,
maybe
I guess you
point.
Just swing to the face with Ashbringer. You could kill Tyrion off her board control, but I think you can also just play your secrets here and then really mess with your opponent's head and then set up a lethal with the weapon in case, in the very worst case scenario, your opponent clears it with Consecration.
I think you definitely go for face here because you set up lethal, as you said, and that Ashbringer is so powerful. You also have the minions on board as well.
By the way, even though Orange got the ghoul from the Balotrer to clear up the board after the power turn with Knife Juggler into Master of a Battle, he's still losing a lot of board control against Hoi's.
That's the advantage of going first without having a preemptive coin play that really swung it. Orange's coin play was on a Keeper of Uldumon. Mm-hmm. Which gave his Zombie Chow a 3-3. And that wasn't really the key play that you need in this mirror. You need to have a dramatic swing on the board like the Mysterious Challenger. He drew his threats a little bit later, but it almost didn't matter because Hoi was one mana crystal ahead. And you can see it. He played Challenger before Orange did. He played Tyrion before Orange did. And it's like, well, all
and
of a sudden,
the silence as well,
he takes the initiative.
Yeah, that's true.
So now Hoi is down. He still has the Paladin, and he stays with Paladin. Orange needs to win with Warrior. And this is the Paladin that we mentioned was 21-1. Right now it's even
22
more.
And 22-1.
How many times can you draw Mysterious Challenger into boom into Tyrion? That's what I'm wondering.
Well, I mean, here's the thing that people are gonna be like, you know, obviously, like, he drew really well, but you're pushing for these cards. Like, you would probably toss away Blessing of Kings, but it's like you're searching actually for Mysterious Challenger. You're not like, well, I hope I get like Pilot Shredder. Which would be nice.
Actually, this is not bad. Like, you might even keep all those cards.
Wait, what? Here? I don't think so. If you keep Secret Keeper, you need to go for double secrets. You would like to go for double secrets against the Patron Warrior from Orange because it pushes so much damage.
Wait, actually,
so you will just toss away Blessing of Kings?
No, I think actually Nips might be right about this.
This is a really good curve, and Blessing of Kings is a great turn 4 card versus Warrior as well.
With so many tokens out, Blessing of Kings is really good against Warrior. As long as they don't have an early execute, particularly because you know Orange is playing Patron Warrior and his lack of removal compared to Control Warrior. Like, Control Warrior has Bash and Shield Slam to really help piece things together. Without an early Unstable Ghoul, it's going to be really hard for Orange to stabilize. I like that keep now that I think about it, because normally when you're curving out early and you're on coin, you do want Mysterious Challenger
and
against Patron.
Absolutely, and he gets Avenge as well, which is great because he has the curve even with the coin. And right now he can go with the Secret Keeper. I'm not actually sure if you do Coin Avenge here.
Probably not. Because you have the Haunted Creeper, and then you evaluate. And if it's really good, like your minions stick, then you coin Blessing of Kings. Because I think even more than just the state of the board, even more than just like playing around patrons, the state of the board is so key because you need to pressure the warrior enough that patrons don't have that dramatic of an impact.
Oh man, he can coin the Blessing as well if he chooses to.
Yes, which almost feels certainly what will happen because that not only puts a pretty good minion on board, but it deals with this Frothing Berserker.
Alright. What about the Orange Hand, though? Like, Frothing into Pilot Shredder seems good. He doesn't have that many spells. He does have Execute for a possible Mysterious Challenger on 6, so it's not bad. Patron is fine as well, but he doesn't have the Activator yet.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is really good for Orange, because a lot of times the Patron Warrior could be stuck armor up passing or just dying. So a lot of times you want the early game draws, like maybe Acolyte with some cool Taskmaster or Whirlwinds, or you just have minions to curve out, and both of those are really powerful to answer the board. But Orange is already stuck at an impasse. You know, he can play Deathspite, he can play Shredder, and both of those have a lot of merit to it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Deathspite was a really good pickup, because not only you deal with the Spider right now without losing your minion, you also set up a possible Whirlwind effect for the future.
So the fact that you play Deathspite delays your minions in the hand unless you want to play Patron Nixon, and I think with only one Whirlwind effect guaranteed in current hand, you can't really go for the Patrons, because that's your win condition against Paladins. So if there's a single True Silver champion, it will help a lot against those Patrons. It might be a huge problem. So I really love that Orange just went for the Pilot Shredder instead.
Well, I do like that idea that Pilot Shredder gets out earlier, because Deathspite does have its places as the game goes on versus Shredder gets weaker. Mm-hmm. But I do think this is a scenario where Oskaka's rule applies to the thing, where Oskaka has a belief that if you don't play Deathspite on turn 4 as a Patron Warrior, you're doing the wrong thing. Obviously, if you have Deathspite, sometimes you don't have it in your hand.
Yeah.
Because let's say the Grim Patron is your winning condition. Well, don't you want it earlier on board before the Mysterious Challenger comes out, so that way you can start forcing pressure and even make Mysterious Challenger not that impactful because Noble Sacrifice, etc.
Yeah, absolutely. Plus, also, if there is a slot, well, there would be no Sludge Belcher because that was turn 4. But if you top deck Inner Rage, you give yourself a chance to actually get this Patron super early as well. But I can understand going with the Shredder.
Yeah, it does seem like it helps him stabilize some of this early board, because now he can execute and Deathspite and set up for stuff. However, I think the state of the board hasn't really changed much, and he actually just took a little bit extra damage from the Creeper, so that could end up biting him if his opponent happened to curve directly into Challenger, because the pressure is going to continue to grow here now that Hoi has more tokens and another Blessing of Kings here.
The second Blessing might be very important, as you said. Because it's you can think about Blessing of Kings as a minion that requires. Let's say it like that. Mm-hmm. It's a rider on a mount. You need a mount, and then you put the rider on it.
It's a very good analogy.
Yeah. So it's like a minion with charge, basically.
So the dude is a mount.
Yes, an
who's
example.
The rider?
Well, you can use the Spectral Spider, then it's actually, you know, it's legit, right? Because you use the Spider's mount.
Yeah. Alright, well, ooh, Orange got a really good Shredder the previous game, which didn't even help him win, but. This is a bad Shredder.
This
you wanted something
actually.
To stick.
This was really important to get that 2-3 or 4-4 an example on board.
Yeah, just something that wouldn't die. I mean, even if it was 2 health, Hoi was prepared to kill it with the weapon plus a dude, but keeping the dude is one extra problem if Mysterious Challenger comes out the next turn. That being said, do you go for Patient or do you go for card draw here with the Acolyte?
I like Patron overall, and I think Mysterious Challenger is not that much of a problem because of the Big Hunter. So Orange is slowly taking the board.
Although Blessing of Kings again is something to deal with one of the Patrons, and it'll only be one target here, so you can silence one Patron and Blessing of Kings the other, and all of a sudden the Patron threat has been abated, picking up Dr. Boom for the following turn. This is a really important swing turn for Hoi, because if Orange doesn't have these Patrons clear the board, and he doesn't have really good follow-ups to this.
Well, there is there is Big Game Hunter as well, so.
Yeah, but then the question becomes, like, you know, how do you actually
you're
win?
You're out of steam, and that's the problem that pointed out for Orange, that the fact that he didn't have a second activator for Grim Patron, which is really needed, because mm-hmm. two Patrons are really easy to deal with. Multiple ways of doing that, and as we can see now, the threat of Patrons will be immediately resolved, and Orange will be left on basically if you want draw a second Patron or Dr. Boom, he might be in very big trouble.
Yeah, he's absolutely running out of steam, but this is a Patron deck, so he might actually draw into his cards.
Wow, really good sequencing here from Hoi. It's very tempting to kill the 3-3 so that the 3-2 gets contested by the Owl.
Yeah.
But this you play around Battle Rage. Yes, exactly. Yeah. This is something that people are often regretting as soon as they think about the play afterwards and like, oh crap, I left the damage minion on board. And then they Battle Rage for an extra card, which goes into like the actual whirlwind, which leads into the snowball effect. And as such, Orange is going to have to rely on something else here to give him some juice. And he's going to use his Frothing Berserker plus Slam for tempo instead of card draw. And will that be enough?
Well, that's a good start, let's say, because right now he has two minions. One can die easily, but Frothing Berserker is all right. And he has an answer to Dr. Boom.
Yeah, this might be the way that Orange comes back. Because we're talking about running out of steam, but that Frothing Berserker just so happens to go uncontested. Unless these Boombots clear Frothing Berserker, that thing could get way out of control.
Yeah, and I just want to say that this Boombot might, the second Boombot might be one of the most important Boombots in Hoi's career.
We'll see.
Especially if he draws a card to Orange.
Like, I mean,
Hoi wants to kill the Frothing, and Orange wants to draw a card.
Oh my god.
Taskmaster.
Wow, okay. That's perfect for mana usage to draw yet another card. And when you shut this down...
Do you want to draw another card when there are two Boombots on the board
and you
would like to have more targets?
You kill the Boombot for sure.
Wow.
Because
Okay.
It worked out somehow.
I mean, still kind of relevant. Because Consecration now completely owns Orange.
There's no Consecration,
wrong 4-drop. Oh, man, this is not a good spot for Hoi at all.
This is so tough because the bomb needs to kill the Frothing. Like, you can't... Can you choose Silver Frothing? This is so much damage, though. You take 7.
No. If you choose Silver Frothing, you die. What you can do is choose Silver something beforehand.
Exactly.
And then increase the chances of it killing the Frothing Berserker.
So that's basically it.
But first I would run over and grab some salt from the kitchen and throw it over your shoulder. Because I think you're going to need a little bit of help here from Mr. Boombot himself.
Absolutely. This Boombot is the key.
Yeah.
So with the True Silver, what do you kill?
Probably the
Beacon Hunter.
Okay, I was going to kill the Acolyte of Pain so he can't like Whirlwind or Battle Rage. So
okay, yeah, that's a good point.
I feel
like
that might be the best case.
And you
but with
13
HP, the one damage... Will it be important?
Wow, is he gonna tank this damage like a man?
Well, the thing is, like, you can't guarantee a kill in it, right? And now you're down to 6, and the Boombot needs to work
needs
to kill
BK
the Hunter.
Okay, so he's like, you know what? My best chance is just to have him run out of steam and completely a like, whirlwind or.
And that was very
else.
Risky. I think it was better just to go for the chances of killing the Frothing Berserker.
The thing is, like, you have a bigger chance to kill Big Game Hunter with the bomb instead of killing
Frothing. But you're losing almost all scenarios anyway.
If you kill Big Game Hunter, you still survive on 1 damage because Acolyte was 3 and Taskmaster was 2. And then it's easier to hit for 1 damage instead
of hitting 3. Or 2 damage if you hit the Frothing. Because what happened would if he killed the Acolyte of Pain with the True Silver Champion, he has a 1 in 4 to hit the Frothing, and he has to win 75% of that. So the odds aren't very high. It's like 18-17%. And he's like, well, maybe I have a higher chance to do this.
And if he survives, he has a chance to pick up Tyrion and then maybe stabilize.
Mm-hmm. That's so far-fetched.
Well, we're going to go to a good old patron warrior mirror. Oh, is that? Oh, it's a control warrior from Hoi.
Well, not certainly. Okay. Slash Belcher doesn't necessarily say it's a control warrior.
But if it is, he's in a great spot.
I think it's patron with Slash Belcher, so let's draw more minions.
Well, he's got Deathspite, and that's good. But Orange has two of the
pieces. It's actual warrior. Nice.
Control warrior, which usually should win against patrons.
It's not impossible for Orange to win, but it's going to be difficult considering that Control Warrior ultimately can just stabilize the board no matter what.
Actually, it's so funny that Hoi made it here to the top 8 and we are uncertain about the deck because he almost never used it.
Yeah, it was always Druid and Paladin.
He was doing like 3-0s, 3-1s on stream, so we didn't see the Warrior at all.
Well, actually, I think he may have legitimately not even played Warrior once.
He played every series,
he either 3-0'd with Paladin or Druid. Mm-hmm. And the one time he lost with Paladin, he just played Druid and won, I think.
Well, he lost one series. And when
have
he lost the series, all your decks
are
getting killed.
It's like, is this the first time he's played Warrior all tournament long?
He had to dust it off, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah, he's like, wait, how do I play this again? Ah, I drew weapons. That is correct. All right. Well, Orange doesn't have the Deathspite.
Well, he doesn't have any weapons, and a weapon would be really good here, even Fire War X.
Yeah, because he would love to kill off the opponent's Acolyte.
And play the Pirate.
Yeah. He might consider just armor up passing here, or Acolyte perhaps Acolyte and Inner Rage his own Acolyte as well.
Well, good news for Orange is that he has Patron, Whirlwinds, Inner Rage, and Coin. So he will be able to play Patrons, but he decides to use Inner Rage here to draw the card. So he is searching for that Death Spite.
Okay.
And that's a good 4-drop as well.
It is. However, with Death Spite coming out here.
Ooh. Oh, and a Harris Jones. Cool. So from this card in Control Warrior, we can assume that Hoey actually predicted that this is might be one of the scenarios in the Last Hero Standing, that he will be facing off a patron warrior against his paladin.
Yep.
Because he is usually starting with the druid. And this way he set up a complete counter deck strategy.
And without Orange's own secret paladin, you know, Hoey knows that he has a very good chance of Patron and Hunter hitting the Control Warrior. So this is a very good prediction. And that Harrison Jones is a dagger in the heart. Orange, not even gonna blink, but that could be just like the beginning of the end already. Because it's like, without that Death Spite, that Grim Patron just lost a significant amount of power.
It's interesting to add that Orange decided not to play Dread Courser for free when he had the Death Spite. He wants to use Dread Courser when he actually needs to protect something, and Dread Courser wouldn't change that much. It could have baited the weapon, but not necessarily as well.
Just a card, True Art comes into hand for Hoey, and that's another really powerful card because, you know, at a certain point, you just gain a lot of armor, and the Patron Warrior runs out of real minions and threats.
So
you could
like
take
to play
it to fatigue.
Right now, right? Because you don't have to develop anything else.
Yeah, certainly. Especially if he didn't play like Armorsmith or Shield Block beforehand, he's gonna play Justicar here on curve.
And this is very nice. Like, even the 6/3 minion on the board is a huge threat because you know that your opponent didn't have a weapon, and he was relying on the top deck from the Death Spite. So really nicely played by Hoey.
But there is that patron with double whirlwind.
Yeah, but then it's.
I think you can set up for something better as time goes on. You don't have to use the coin there, because in fact you might want to whirlwind coin execute to deal with threats on the board. Because if you whirlwind twice, Justicar's a 6/1 and just so happens to kill a very clean patron. But with cards like Bash, with Death Spite in hand, and even Shield Slam and Fiery War Axes, Hoey will be able to pick off almost any amount of patrons here that Orange can put out.
Bash and Shield Slam is such a great synergy between those two cards because you can clear patrons with just 4 mana. So
yep. Followed by like a weapon. You can squeeze in a weapon there as well.
6 mana to kill 3 patrons. That's almost like killing all of them.
Yeah, practically speaking.
It's really amazing. Also, after playing Justicar, he can use the hero power. So not only he is just killing all the threats, like even if Orange gets some threats on the board, he will be able to armor up beyond the amount of damage.
Nope. Well, looks like he sequenced it to gain one less armor. So, Hoey.
Oh no.
Hoey messing up.
Mistakes were made.
Is he getting nervous?
No, that's the problem, that he didn't play this deck at all.
He's getting rusty.
I think he played it once and lost with it.
Yeah.
Because he had to play it when he lost the match, right? So he's 0-1 with this deck.
Do you go for it? I mean, it's one of the things that has Orange, like the longer you wait, the higher likelihood he has for Brawl. And this is also one of the weakest boards that Warrior could have because he already has a Death Spite set up. Therefore, he might clone more patrons by attacking into it. And there's also an Armorsmith. So I think this is Orange's best chance. But even without Brawl, Hoey has really powerful tools here to just clean everything up.
So it's 4 patrons and does Bash, Slam, Attack into 3/3, and that's it.
You just Bash.
Bash, slam, attack,
and then you have
free two.
And then you have the effect. Or you can even bash. Oh, yeah. I think that's the best case. I was like,
Bash, slam is 4 mana.
Wondering if he could do anything else with the mana, but yeah, it's good.
You can even play Armorsmith if you want. There is 8 mana, right?
Yes, I see. It's
Armorsmith, armor up.
I love Bash. It's got this just such a neat design.
Flew under the radar for TGT predictions. I mean, people said it was like an okay card, but it actually turns out to be pretty good.
It counters Shredder and also works really well to protect yourself at the same time as killing minions.
Yeah, I think the fact that like Darnassus Aspirant also got popular, so then like people like Aspirant into Shredder, and it's like, oh, I just bash shield slam for four. It's like, well, I don't take as much damage.
Oh man, so it's up for Orange now. Now double whirlwind is lost. Deathbite has been used. He doesn't have any whirlwind effects. He doesn't have the weapon.
Yeah, but what he does know is that a lot of his opponent's removal has been exhausted, and he could tuck this Grim Patron behind.
No, he goes for the Frozen Berserker. That's interesting. Okay. I thought that he would go for the winning play, which just is Patron here. Because if your opponent doesn't have the answer to the Patron, you might just straight out push so much minions on board with those two armor smiths that you might be
in the course of
a
couple
game.
Turns.
Yes.
Because next turn you attack, you get two Patrons. Next turn you attack, so your opponent doesn't have answers for a couple of turns.
You know, I mean, this is really a really long plan, but as the game progress, Howie is just gonna draw his brawl, gonna draw his every
yep.
single answer that he needs for the Patrons, and just getting harder and harder for Orange to take it.
I think you need the Patron because you want to draw into this another Deathbite, maybe Inner Rage. So right now you're waiting for Battle Rage.
But even if he has Battle Rage, how does he activate it?
Well, he needs the Deathbite. Well, he needs the Deathbite to attack into something like Shredder to get the damage, to get lower. Acolyte of Pain is alright as well. Orange just needs the cards. If he draws the rest of his deck, he'll have a chance to fight back versus Hoi, because Hoi is out of resources more or less. But Hoi is in a great situation anyway. With that shield block and still draw cards, Geddon is nice as well.
It'll come down to fatigue, certainly. Like, that's part of the reason why we're talking about Justicar being a huge thing, because Orange just might be tossing everything and the kitchen sink at Hoi. But, I mean, Hoi will have the tank up. Tank up! I'm out of cards!
Hoi has all the time in the world.
With Shield Maiden, it's like he can tank this this Frothing Berserker straight up. He's got double Armor Smith! Like, he legitimately might just hit like 50 to 60 health.
Yeah, that's actually a possibility. And Orange can't just slam minions on board to lose them.
No, watch this. Oh, wait.
Yeah, he got the Shield Maiden as well.
Almost 50 health.
That's a lot of power.
How can you deal that? I mean, do you think that Hearthstone will incorporate a card that is dealing unpreventable damage that goes through the armor, it leaves it up, and just deals instant damage
like
to the HP?
Piercing?
Yeah, something like that.
At some
it's
point,
a good
maybe.
Point, because if you
Priest
have,
would be great
you could have
that.
100 armor,
and
but if you have, but if you have zero, if you have zero health, you die still.
Yeah.
So,
and that's like a great card, a great keyword for Priest to have, like, you know, Bind Blast. Having an unpreventable damage, something like that?
We had it in WoW TCG, and there were a couple of cards like that.
But that's very specific hate for only two classes, which is Warrior and Druid.
And Mage.
I guess, yeah, that's true. Mage through the Ice Barrier. So, with three classes, maybe.
Oh my god, Battle Rage is active! He can draw a card!
Finally. And draw a card is what he will do, most likely.
But he needs something like... Okay, Big Hunter is not bad.
Oh, I guess he's just going to wait one more turn before he... Yeah, maybe he gets one more Whirlwind. No, he already used both Whirlwinds.
Yeah, he did.
He might need Inner Rage and then Battle Rage.
Inner Rage, Deathbite into Fireworks. It's really bad for Orange.
All I know is I have a fever, and the only cure is more armor. Wow.
This is kind of...
Taskmaster's just like... see, the very funny thing is that... Hoi's not really BMing Orange. He actually just can't kill him, which is like the most frustrating thing about Control Wars. Like, I'm sorry, man. I really actually can't kill you, so we're going to go much longer. I'm going to gain even more armor.
Doing my best here.
He's at 60 health, FYI, with upside to maybe 70 if he can continue to use Taskmaster and armor up here.
Why don't you go for just the Wrathguard from the Plateau Shredder to kill him instantly?
Yeah, that's a good point. He might just Baron get in here. I think that is probably his plan.
Shield slam to the face.
You kind of want to deny the minions because of the Battle Rage, right? So you want to kill everything so that Orange will never draw any cards. And for now, you know he has the coin. And
You do know that he has a BGH. It's not a BGH. Dr. Boom and a Grommash, but you even still have your BGH.
Yeah. And you have Shield slam to kill whatever is being played.
Wow. 77. Oh, sorry, 67 health.
Well, at this point, the problem is actually that not only Orange doesn't have the board, but even if he gets the board at some point, just plowing through all that armor might prove to be impossible.
Yeah. And you know what? He needs to hang in here. Like, there is a very small chance in his mind that he could have this board do a lot of damage. And with Frothing Berserker, I mean, you never know. You can catch up. But the likelihood is very slim. I would say it's in the it's like the point single digits, or even lower. Because this warrior, like, would have to have the worst hand in the history of Hearthstone.
And he still has armor up four per turn, so, you know, it's not easy to go through even with a Frothing Berserker.
Now Kaelin is even on the problem. So Battle Rage time, finally.
Yeah, Battle Rage, something to activate the Grim Patron. I mean, that challenges
the... That's something, right?
Baron Geddon.
And Sehar doesn't really have cards that can put more pressure on board for now.
Yeah, he's still going to keep this game going. I'm sorry, bro.
Well, he can shield slam the 5-5.
Yeah.
7-5 still stays on board, but...
He'll draw a card from the Acolyte of Pain.
44 damage! Yeah, we're talking about what if shield slam and execute did 100 damage worth? It's actually halfway to that point.
Yeah, it does work like that.
What a yoke.
Sylvanas! That's more pressure. And finally, Deathspite.
God. Well, Deathspite is something. And he will survive. He will survive another turn.
What do you attack with Deathspite? Do you just go for face?
Go face. There's nothing else to do here.
Yeah, just get that armor down.
Ooh, that scratch on the armor.
Felt
he
good.
Got him below 70.
So almost there. Almost there. As long as it's below 100.
Listen, it's going in the right direction.
Well, he is dealing damage, right? That's something.
But yes, dealing damage is often better than just sitting here taking damages from Baron Geddon to the face.
It's a good strategy. Like, deal damage to your opponent actually dies.
Hoi thinking about if he wants to even play the Belcher here. I mean, he
might just play Sylvanas if he wants to.
Sylvanas is just more power, and I think that almost guarantees lethal.
Well, the
and
thing
it
is
takes Patron's back. Haha.
Yeah, Sylvanas is always good when your opponent has to play Patience. And this might be the last turn for Orange. He's already at 11.
Almost certainly will be. With Inner Rage, though, that gives him the opportunity to Battle Rage before he Whirlwinds. So you play Grim Patron. Or is he gonna clear everything first? No, there's no way. You can't.
He would have to draw and execute, and he used already one. I'm not sure about the second.
He might feel like he has to kill Sylvanas before he plays the Grim Patron, but I think his best chance here is just to go for the Battle Rage.
Yeah, draw the cards.
And then maybe even draw Execute, number two. Oh, he's just going... Yeah, draw Execute, number two, and then deal with the last remaining Patron.
But he needs to armor up.
Didn't he use Double Execute already?
Oh, did he? I haven't been keeping track.
I'm not sure. Like, we're a Warrior, so we've seen a couple of Executes.
And that's it.
Three cards. Slam keeps... Is Hope alive for one more second? I mean, he can slam and coin armor up.
Well, if he gets a patron, then there is Taskmaster, right? So it's 5 damage at least. So, yeah, still barely alive.
Is this the end?
Unless it takes the 5-1. No, you can't Taskmaster,
okay,
though.
Okay, this is hilarious. He's going to steal a patron, and he's going to Taskmaster that to create more patrons. Look at me, look at me, look at me. I'm the patron warrior now.
Wow.
Oh, wait, never mind.
He got Taskmaster, though.
Yeah, but he can't Taskmaster for lethal.
There's a weapon.
Right, and that's it. An hour and a half later, Hoi is the first person to go to the round of four, and Orange Run will stop once again at a top eight, but what a great performance yet again for both these guys.
Yeah, absolutely. Another top eight on his under his belt at here at DreamHack. 200 players, and you're one of the eight.
Yeah. So, you know, good stuff all around. I think it's somewhat fitting that Hoi continues on, but he did it 3-2. It's like it's not the same rounds before. You know, people are coming here really prepared. They know your decks. Everyone knows each other's decks. Mm-hmm. And the competition's getting really fierce. So it's not the 3-0 sweeps that Hoi's been used to, and it's getting really uncomfortable because, you know, some of those games were really tight, and if it went the opposite direction – then who knows? You know, maybe he wouldn't get the favorable matchups that he wanted.
Actually, for me, it seems like Hoi had this deadly trap set. So we were really excited about his Paladin performance, about his Druid performance. But what really mattered was the fact that at the end, he had that Control Warrior set for the Patron that can actually win versus his decks. So he was performing really well. And then the deadly trap was sprung against Orange, and Orange actually died to it.
All right, well, Hoi is joining us here for a couple of words. So, yeah, man, top four. But I think that was, like, kind of expected. I think it'd be shame if you went on the streak you did and then lost in the first round of the playoffs.
Yeah, it would feel really bad. But it was a really intense series.
Yeah,
I think the first game decided it all, Detroit versus Honda.
Yes.
That was a very important match.
Yeah, because then I could count on from there.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we talked about, that you had... You did start with Druid just to set up the Control Warrior counter on the Patron if he will be countering your Paladin,
right? Also, that, but Druid didn't counter any of his class specific. It's like Druid is often like 40-60 or 50-50. So, it's not like I want to save the Druid to counter any specific class.
Yeah, so that's just grab a win and hopefully get you on the board.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I do have a question. Oh, go ahead, Lothar, you first.
Okay, I have a question too. How many times did you play a Control Warrior?
That was my question! All right, my question is, is that the first time you played Control Warrior?
And my question is, does the one armor you missed influence the matchup in any way?
Right.
That was the 2% of the armor he had.
It was the fourth time I played.
Fourth time in 3 days.
Fourth time, yeah. All right. I'm 2-2 with it now, so.
Ah, you should cut that from your lineup.
Yeah, I should cut it.
You should only play two decks. That's enough.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. Well, you know what, man? Did you prepare at all specifically for this? Because, like, for this match, because I think the deck lists were released for the round of eight. Did you do anything specific last night at all?
Yeah, I checked out the Owen secrets. What secret he had in Honda and what secret he had in his secret. And he only played like four secrets, I think, or five. So.
Yeah. Okay.
So you
Did you study his pick order?
No, I didn't do that. Okay. But it's really often that you open with Honda because it's almost the same as Druid.
Gotcha.
And your warrior in your lineup was specifically counter patron.
Yeah, but I kind of regret picking Control Warrior because I didn't expect so many paladins. There have been so many mid range paladins and secretins, so I think patron is a better choice overall. But Control Warrior is definitely better against patron.
Better against patron.
Yeah, I got an edge now.
I was surprised considering that your teammates, Six Onos Kako, specifically point out that they think Patron is still like probably the best deck, or if not one of the best decks.
Yeah, but I had some bad experience with it in the last tournament. I played Na'Vi Chemist League.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and so on.
Gotcha. So,
I'm also really happy that I got so long in this tournament because I haven't really performed well since I joined Na'Vi.
Well, so what are you talking about, man? You got to the EU finals.
Yeah,
that's sick.
But then.
And then you got cheesed by Osaka killing you twice.
Ambitious.
Osaka's like, well, I have a lineup really good against Hoi, so I'll just beat him twice and go through those cards.
That's a good,
like,
really good mindset.
Kills my dream by the fun.
You're never satisfied, right? You always want to have.
Yeah, I really want to be consistent. It's not about the prize money. I just want to play my best. And if I played my best and lose, I don't care. But if I played bad and lose, I'm really upset.
Okay. Well, you're doing really well, man. Top four yet again in another event. Congratulations. Is there anything you want to say before we let you go to the semifinals?
Yeah, just shout out to my teammates and to Na'Vi. It's, they're awesome.
Best team in the world. Sorry, G2. I know you guys held that title for a while, but...
we'll prove you wrong.
I'm sure, man. The more I see it, I think Na'Vi's just really good.
Gosho ranking. I think G2 is number two and Na'Vi's number one.
All right.
Oh, power rank!
Because I'm dragging them down.
I was like, well, all right.
Shots?
It's like, I'd like to announce my retirement today after this moment just to improve the rankings. Well, congratulations, Toy. You are the first semifinalist. In the meantime, guys, we are going to take a break and get ready for our second quarterfinals. You're watching DreamHack Winter Grand Prix, #DHW15. And when we return, we're going to come back with our second match. Stay tuned.